Welcome to the Asian Racing Report podcast. I'm Michael Cox and I'm joined by a very special guest for episode 3, Brazilian jockey Joe Moreira, champion in Singapore, Brazil and Hong Kong. Welcome to the podcast. We don't want to tell your whole life story today, but we want to talk about horses and your relationship with horses and what horses have taught you in life. Now, the first horses that you rode weren't race horses and they weren't your horse. You were jumping the fences in Curitiba and just jumping on horses. Tell us about your first experience getting on horses.
Thanks for having the channel, Michael. It pretty much described how it happened, you know. I used to live in a little town which there wouldn't be much people around. And I've made few friends that actually introduced me to horses. And the way how we used to get onto these horses would be stealing horses, as you just described. So obviously being a little kid, probably 8 or 9 years old, never been that close to horses before. When these fellas gave me the words that we were gonna steal a horse, of course I would be extremely scared, very scared of putting myself in such a situation of stealing a horse, as well as jumping on a horse, you know? But just don't forget, this sort of horse that I jumped on for the very first time, they were not race horses. They were like cold blood kind of horses. You would come approach them. They wouldn't even put their heads up trying to run away. They would just sit there and wait for you to grab a hold of them and get on board. So these fellas told me that we were going to steal a horse. We went around the city, around the little town to try to find them. And we found one, which we straight away, we gave them a name. They were called Dumbs, because they were just so quiet, extremely quiet. I would just be brave enough to just go over my fears and get on top of them. Obviously, being so young and so short, I would need a help from somebody else to get on top. But I still remember the feeling of it would be amazing having that experience of getting on the horses, even them being so stiff kind of horses, like wouldn't be able to gallop, you know, nice and smooth gallop. But just having that feeling of bouncing up and down on their back would be just amazing. A feeling that I still have every day of my life up until now. And I will just keep on having it because I got addictive to it. Like, you know, being on the horse's back is such a pleasure for myself. Which is no doubt it start off back then, maybe when I was only 8 or 9 years old.
So you love riding, you're addicted to it. I think a lot of the time I hear this word relating to you is a natural, that you're a natural, that he's a natural talent. And especially compared to Zach, they say, oh, Zach Purton, your rival in Hong Kong, he's someone who thinks about racing. He thinks his way through, but you're just a natural talent. But actually, when you talk to people from your hometown, Curitiba, you're not a natural talent at all. They told me that they put you on one side of the horse, you fall off the other, that you're actually a very poor rider as an apprentice when you first started.
They are right about it because, of course, nobody else was born with talent, in my opinion. And when I started off, I mean, start riding race horses, I had no experience at all, even if I had the experience of stealing horses from our neighbor around my city. Those sort of horses wouldn't give me experience to ride race horses. They were just too quiet, you know. I had some falls from them. I had some accidents, like crashes and all of those things. But even though, when you get them on a race horse, it's totally different. Totally different. So when I start off riding race horses, having no experience with them, I just struggle a lot. When they said that I used to get on from one side and fell on the other, they really mean that. But, you know, I just had to find my way through, learn on how to actually get the balance, really understand the horses and really try to keep them together, because to lose a horse is just so easy. Like, you get on a horse and you don't really understand how its character. If you do something wrong with them, it's just a trigger for them to just buck you off, drop you on the track, and from there on. So they were right about it. And of course, it's just part of my story. I just had to make it tough, in a tough way, to learn my process. And I don't think I was born with talent that people might think that I was. I just had to work extremely hard to develop some skills and understand racehorses in particular.
The person that you mentioned most as a formative, as a mentor and a teacher, technically, is Ivan Quintana, who was a great jockey himself, an interesting character as a trainer, and an incredible horseman, and had a great sense with animals. What did he teach you technically about riding that you changed, and how did he teach you about how to relate to the horse?
Well, it's a story being told many times that he gave me opportunities I wasn't able to deliver based on my capability, being so inexperienced, so I wasn't able to deliver. By doing so, he actually scolded me and asked me to leave, and by not leaving, and then he realized he had to come and teach me. So he started teaching me in this way. He pulled me from the Jockeys Academy one day, got me into his stable, and he got himself on a horse. Just before that, he had a heart surgery, not long before, and by him doing that, he was expressing to me that he was willing to teach me and help me. The first few things that he taught me was on how I should be holding the reins, which I still get questions, a lot of questions until nowadays about it, and how I should be carrying the whip on my hands, that would be making sure that I have fully control of the horse. Just don't forget, when he gave me that initial opportunity I wasn't able to deliver, was by me not being capable to have full control of the horse. And also, right away, he asked me to just try to posture myself on the horse's back in such a way. But that wouldn't be the only things that he taught me. He taught me about the horse's character and personality, a lot about pacing of races, how I should be dealing with circumstances when the race circumstances present at the races, like if a pace of the race is just too slow, what should I do if I'm in each position? Like, let's say if the pace is too slow, let's say if I'm in front and I'm setting up a very slow run pace. Right away, he taught me, like, if you had an easy run in front, make sure you start building up from the 600 meters onwards. That means 3-4 long. And you might leave them flat foot or unexpectable, build up momentum at the time that they were not expect. And then even if they do have a stronger turn of foot, you having a head start for being having a full horse, getting to the straight and having that head start, which will make for the bet makers find it so much harder for themselves to catch you up. So these sort of things, that is what he started teaching me, but it's very much technical, right? And when it comes to the point on understanding the horses themselves, he taught me about on how to manage a horse in the gate. And he used to give me example of older jockeys like Antonio Bolin, which used to be a fantastic rider in the past, which used to be extremely calm. One of the most calm jockeys that has ever turned up in Brazil. Even these days, people still say this. This is what Quintana used to teach me, and a lot of other things I've learned as time went by, but mainly about Quintana is he mentioned to me about how important it is you to keep the nerves of the horses calm, in particular at the start of a race. Like, make sure the horse is calm in there and well focused to make sure when the gates open, they jump out as fast as possible. Another point, which is also technical, when you get a horse in the gate, you gotta make sure it's nice and sitting square. That means, like, if a horse has 1 foot a little bit further forward or too far back, or if it's the front and back feet are too apart from each other, that particular point, that means the first stride of the horse cannot be to the biggest of the extent. But if you have it too short, that is a very high risk of you stumbling at the start. So you have to be nice and square. And then from there on, the horse has got its maximal capacity of jumping out as fast as possible. So these technical points that Quintana taught me, no doubt it was crucial for me to be able to, from there on, start off deliver good results and performance at the races.
When you first get on a horse in the parade ring, whether you've ridden it before or not, is there a checklist? Is there something that you do every time that you get on a horse when you first get on that parade ring. Like, obviously, that's when the process starts, even before you get to the gates. You're walking around, you get legged aboard.
That is not a checklist for myself, but I know things that I usually do, and obviously people have taught me about it, you know. I straight away get into the parade ring and I look at the horses to see how they're parading. It's very important to know if they are calm and relaxed or if they are nervous and sweating, right? So a few points already tell you. If you get a horse that is extremely agitated, sweating, the chance of this horse being already wasting part of his energy that he should be using in the race, it's massive. So I look at the horses straight away and I see if they're calm or nervous, sweating or not sweating. So I do that very often. And how it's carrying its head around, if it's having a good look around or if it's just calm and relaxed and going through the motions. Those things also tell you on how you should behave yourself as a rider when you get on. So let's put it this way. If you get on a horse that is extremely excited and agitated, of course, you just have to be as calm as possible, calm them down, give them a touch, try to build up connection to keep the nerves, because this sort of horse is so easy for you to dig them up, give them a dig with your leg or jump on the horse, you by accidentally give them a bump on their flanks or anything. They just get worse and they waste even more and more energy. So when I get on those horses, I obviously get on them as gentle as possible, try to keep them calm. And then we go on to see if we're able to hold it all together until we get into the gate and start racing. Look. But when it comes to a horse that is extremely calm or maybe too calm, and then comes to another point, which is the rider being capable to get on the horse's mind and switch them on, you know? Like if you get a horse that is extremely calm, I get on first, I have a feel of it first, and then also its movement tells a little bit if it's very much on or if it's a bit too switch off. And then I work on a little bit. Sometimes you just give a very loud yell to the horse, give them a dig with the legs down to wake them up. Or sometimes you tap the whip on their shoulder to make sure they start switching on, you know. Sometimes I speed up and I yell, get them to get the blood circulation to flush quicker into their body system. So that helps them to really wake up, you know. This is a very crucial point also, because you have to get on the horse and try to understand them, each other, individual, and then work on it. Otherwise, if you just go with just one dimension on every horse, you're unlikely to get the best out of them always.